Hey everyone, so today I'll be interviewing top welterweight prospect contender out of Canada, living in Vegas, undefeated, fighting out of the PBC, Cody Crowley. Hey champ.
Hey brother, thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
No problem.
It's an honor to be on your show.
Thank you. It's an honor to have you here as well. I appreciate it. We're just going to begin. I just want to ask you right away, you know, you're just coming off a great win in your career. You know, probably the biggest fight so far to date. Who do you want to call out next? Who do you want next?
You know what? I think a great fight for me would be Keith Thurman.
It's
kind of a lot of people might say that's a little bit too soon because of the name, the pay-per-view name that he has, the superstardom. But I believe the position that he's holding at 147, you know, he's been injured a lot. He's taken a lot of time out of the ring. And I believe I can fill that position. The opponents that he's fighting, there's a whole bunch of great world champions at 147. And I believe a lot of those fighters are on their way out and I'm on the way in. You know, young, 27, just climbing the rankings. And I think Keith Thurman would be a great fight for me to really showcase my true talent and what I'm capable of doing inside of the ring. And the credibility factor for it, I believe it'll just shoot me right over everybody else. A lot of other top 10 guys in the world getting a win over Keith Thurman. So that's something I'm going to be trying to pursue very soon.
Great. So you're a young up-and-coming contender. Maybe not every single person has seen your last fight. Tell all the people that want to see your next fight, tell them what they should expect from you, your fight style, and what the show that they should expect next time they see you in the ring.
When you come to a Cody Crowley fight, you should be ready for an action-packed fight, an aggressive fighter that keeps coming forward, throws a shit ton of punches, tries to make the fight happen even if somebody doesn't want to fight. They're just action-packed. That is what I'm here to do. I'm here to entertain the fans, and I just love to fight. Boxing, yes, there's an art to it. There's a very technical game to it, a lot of science, but I'm just there to do what I love to do, and that's fighting. If I had it my way, I would fight in a telephone booth and just go blow for blow and see who's the last man standing. That's how I like to do it. So I'm patiently waiting for an opponent that I step in the ring with when we can just go rock 'em, sock 'em, robots like that, you know. A nice durable opponent who will keep coming. Everybody says they do that when they fight me, but round 2, 3, 4, they end up on the ropes until, you know, round 10 or 12. So safe to say you're going to get an action-packed fight whenever Cody Crowley fights.
Great. I just wanted to know, you know, since you're a boxer, you know, that's your main thing. What are some of your hobbies outside of the ring? Some things that you do to keep your mind off boxing?
You know, to keep my mind off boxing, I try and train my mind a lot. Relaxation techniques. I try to do a lot of meditation, a lot of sun gazing in the morning. Just real holistic methods to keep my body as healthy as possible and my brain as healthy as possible. So yeah, meditation, breath work, sun gazing, and then of course for fun stuff, I love getting out hiking, I love going four wheeling. I just love being in nature, you know. I think every true warrior stems from nature, goes back to our ancestors, and yeah. That's about it. Not too much, bro. I love to fight and I love to be in nature.
Mm-hmm. Great. What advice do you have to future generations of the sport, people that want to get into boxing? What advice would you give to them?
Never give up. In this sport, it's unlike any other sport. When you play hockey, it's okay if you lose a game. If you playing baseball, basketball, whatever, you know, you can go a 20 and 20 season and it's okay, right? In boxing, everything feels like life or death. And it's really not, but that's the way we treat it, because, you know, you can get hurt in the ring, you never fight again, or one loss could deteriorate your whole entire career and another opportunity you think won't happen. But I truly believe that it is who can sacrifice the most and who is willing to endure the most physical and mental pain. Now, that being said, mental pain as in, you know, a fight gets canceled. You lose a fight. You can't go to a family wedding or a best friend's funeral or birthday party because you're in training camp for a fight. It's all sacrifices. Who can endure the most pain? Because eventually, you know, everybody's got two hands. Everybody can throw a punch. So everybody's going to get their shot and their opportunity. They just have to be able to be patient enough and be ready for when the opportunity comes. And a lot of these fighters, they give up before that opportunity comes. This sport is all about how much am I willing to sacrifice and hang on until I get my shot. And a lot of guys, they might be right there an inch away from it and they just let go. They say, oh, my last 7 fights have fallen out. I'm done with this game, you know? Or, you know, I've been trying for 10 years. I'm just done for this game. And when literally, you know, their very next fight, they could have got a call and filled in for a world title or something. You just never know in this game. So it's basically who wants it the most, who's willing to sacrifice the most, and who's willing to never give up, basically. And that's what I've been relying on my whole entire career. You know, I moved here to Vegas with a 10-year game plan. Most people wouldn't carve out a decade of their life for one small goal. You know, that's a lot of time to sacrifice. And I carved out that time from 21 to 31 that I'm not going to do nothing but eat, sleep, breathe boxing. For 10 years, a whole decade, I'm going to give up everything. And I truly believe that's the type of mentality that a fighter needs in this game. I've been surrounded by a lot of great fighters, a lot of guys that have so much more natural God-given talent than me. And stuff happens to them outside of the ring that gets to them mentally. And the next thing you know, they're not there. But if you keep picking away at it day after day after day, no matter what obstacle comes in front of your way, you will be presented with an opportunity and your hard work will be paid off. You know, I'm 6 years in it now, 6 years in the 10-year game plan. And I'm, you know, hopefully 1 to 2 fights away from a world title. So just shows that no matter what obstacle gets presented, if you keep going, you'll either get over it or you'll break through it.
Great, great wisdom, great, you know, philosophy of looking at the sport. You know, you've been into boxing, you have this 10-year plan. What got you into boxing? What made you want to become a boxer?
To be honest, it was because I had a lot of you could say depression. I had no self-esteem. I was kind of chubby, overweight kid, and it really bothered me the outlook that everybody else had of me. So I got into boxing for that sake, trying to, you know, prove to people that, you know, I'm not a chunky little fat kid. You know, I can do something if I want to. And it just kind of snowballed from there. It actually kind of turned me into an animal where I'm gonna outwork everybody.
Great. It's a really interesting story. You know, you're from Canada, you moved to Vegas. What inspired that move to Vegas to become a better fighter?
You know what? I knew that I didn't have the most natural God-given talent and the resources. You know, I was training myself in my garage for most of my amateur career. And, you know, an amateur boxing club, you know, twice a week in town where there was only one or two actual fighters at the club. Mostly a fitness center. So I didn't have the resources that I need to put myself in the best position to be successful at this sport. So what I did was I was trying to be real strategic about it and place myself in the best possible situation for success. And I found out Las Vegas is the fight capital of the world. There's the best fighters here, the best sparring here, the best coaches here, the best opportunities were here. So I packed my bags and came up with a game plan, and me and my wife moved here and taking advantage of all the opportunities.
It's great. It's a really interesting story as well. I'm very smart because Vegas has some of the best training and gyms. So
yes. Yeah. And a lot of people, everybody knows that, but nobody is willing to make that sacrifice or that move for it. Mm-hmm. Not very many anyways.
So the whole pandemic came, it changed the sport. I remember you had a fight scheduled for the Jamal James Delore undercard that got canceled. So then you fought in September on the Ugas undercard. So you fought with no crowd. How was that experience? And what'd you think of it?
Very different. Very different. A lot calmer. It was weird. In the locker room, I was trying to psych myself up. It didn't feel like we were going out for a fight. You know, usually you have that buildup. You can hear the crowd out there. You can feel the energy of the crowd. So not having that was just awkward and weird. And I didn't like it. You know, us fighters, we love the, what fuels us is, you know, when we can't get up in between a round, when we think we have no more gas in us, when we're tired, hearing those loved ones in the crowd and hearing the fans scream and cheering us on when we don't think we can go one more round, getting up for them, that's what motivates us. So it's definitely not right not having people there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and many fighters would agree with you as well. So you fight at welterweight 147. Is that a weight you can make comfortably, or do you have any plans of moving up or moving down in the future?
I want to collect a world title at 47, and then move up to 54. So I want to be a 2-time world champion at 47 to 54.
Mm-hmm. That's great. Since you're in the PBC, and that's where 147 has the most champions and 154 has the most champions, is that partially what inspired you to go that route because of the stable that they have there?
Definitely. Just like the move to Vegas, going with a promoter, we looked at who has the better resources and who has the best tools for us to maneuver with. And PBC had the best roster that I fit into. They had a lot of great champions that are on their way out. You know, they only have 1 to 3 fights left and they're out the door. So I feel like it's a perfect time to roll out the red carpet for me to make my walk in.
Yeah, it's a very good point as well. So at 147, there's some other very known prospects, you know, Jaron Ennis just fought Virgil Ortiz. What do you want to tell the people who are overlooking you and looking at them and not paying enough attention to Cody Crowley?
You know what? I got nothing to prove to no one. I got nothing to say to anybody. They'll find out. I keep working. Eventually, they're gonna find out who I am. You know, I'm not in this sport to prove to anybody that I'm better than anybody else. Me getting my hand raised after a fight, that doesn't mean that I'm better than the person beside me. You know, that just means that I had a better game plan that night. So, you know, I respect all fighters. And for the people who don't give me the credit yet, they haven't seen what they want to see yet. So I can't be upset with them. You know, they have their own outlook and they have their own perspective. So it's just going to be nice that once they do see me, I'll be happy for them to become a fan.
Great. For sure. That's the best way of looking at it. So when you were younger, when you got into the sport, which were some of your inspiration fighters? What fighters did you look up to?
Well, my very first boxing fight that I ever watched was Floyd Mayweather and Oscar De La Hoya. And so right from there, both of those guys I looked up to. And it was kind of funny watching the good guy versus the villain for that fight. You know, the whole – I think that's when the 24/7 first came out. So it got me really hooked on boxing. And then I became a Floyd Mayweather fanatic. from that. So I would say Floyd for sure.
It's a great fighter to look at, you know, undefeated, always found a way to win. Your style is very relentless. That's what I noticed. You throw lots of punches. You don't stop coming. You break your opponent's will. Do you think that could be your key against someone like Keith Thurman, who's shown vulnerability to the body, shown that he could slow down the later rounds?
Definitely. I bring a type of pace that most fighters can't, they don't expect and they can't prepare for. You can't find us. There's only one Cody Crowley. You can't find a sparring partner to mimic Cody Crowley. So no matter how hard they work, when they get in the ring on fight night, they're in the ring with something that they've never had to deal with before. And I make fighters think that they train hard. They think that they're able to go through certain amount of pain, but I bring some sort of type of pressure that I've been able to adapt that literally makes them collapse and suffocate. And that basically makes them sink or swim. And basically a lot of them choose to just sink and slowly go downhill and not fight and just cover up. And then they drowned and lose the fight. Usually a shutout.
Exactly. That's the exact way I put it as well. Now, you just fought in September. Is there any date that you plan on returning? Do you plan on returning to the end of 2020, maybe early 2021?
I'm hoping for November 21st.
Oh, Spence undercard?
Yes, that is what I'm aiming for. That'd be a great fight. Keith Thurman fight on that for a co-main event would be a great card.
Yeah, definitely. There's a good chance they might set up winners versus each other.
That would be great.
Especially, you know, this young kid coming out the scene beating Keith Thurman, you know, out of nowhere, that gives a whole new, you know, landscape to the welterweight division.
Definitely. Yep. That's the plan. And so I got, you know, I just fought. I took a little vacation, enjoyed myself, gained some weight. And, you know, that date is 9 weeks away. So that kind of seems like a perfect fit. So I'm going to be talking to PBC and see if we can line this up.
That's great. If you beat Keith Thurman, you know, that's going to elevate you all the way up in the rankings. You know, you're going to be a new guy to look at. If for some reason the Keith Thurman fight can't go through, is there any other guy you're looking at, or you focus primarily on Keith?
Jamal James would be another good option. You know, just the title that he won there. That would be that. I believe that win would put me in a great position as well to then attack a Keith Thurman type of fight or another world champion.
Exactly. Great as well. You know, when you just said your training camp, you know, 9 weeks and stuff, how long do you prefer to get a good training camp in? If it was up to you, what do you think is like too much training or not enough training? What do you think is the perfect balance?
I think about eight weeks of hard training. But then again, if you're already in shape, I like to stay in shape a lot. So, you know, I might only need, like my last fight, I really only had a 2 week camp for my last fight. Just because I stayed in moderate shape year round and then opportunity came up and we jumped on it. But as long as I have about a good 6 to 8 weeks, I believe I'm ready to go a hard 12 rounds.
Great. You know, when this whole pandemic's over and everything's back to normal, would you like to fight in your home country of Canada again?
Definitely. I have a lot of people in Canada. We get behind our people. We support our people. So, you know, something like that, you know, get a whole country behind me. That'd be a great fight against somebody like Manny Pacquiao. You know, someone who has a whole country behind him, mega superstar. Bring a fight like that over to Toronto, you know, in the Air Canada Center. Something like that would be very big for Canada. And that's something that I'd definitely like to do.
When it comes to the diet of a fighter, what do you think is the perfect diet for a professional fighter?
Ooh, to be honest, I'm still playing around with that. My whole life, I always had high protein diets, eating like a crazy athlete. And then I ended up getting fatty liver disease, a whole bunch of other health issues. And then I started going plant-based and vegan. And but then I had some issues while I was trying to train. Sometimes I would get too skinny and I wouldn't have enough muscle and I wouldn't recover properly. So I'm still playing to see what fits my body best. No human body is identical to another human body. So no specific diet should work for the same person. You know, everybody's body is going to metabolize all the nutrients differently. So I think it's just key for everyone else to really sit down and figure out what works best for them.
Great. Well, thank you so much for doing this interview. Right before you wrap it up, maybe let people know your social medias, where to find you.
Yeah, social media. Hit me up on Instagram, Cody Crowley Boxing. Super simple, not a complicated guy. Come find some cool tips about fitness, health, wealth, everything like that. Cody Crowley Boxing. Yeah, that's about it. Thank you for having me on, bro. I appreciate it.
No problem. I appreciate it. Looking forward to your next fight. Good luck in the future.
Thanks, buddy. Take care.
You too.